Hello friends, so today let us discuss about sarcoid osseous topic from Harrison. So this notes is prepared from the latest edition of Harrison. So I personally prepared the notes, so I made sure no important topic or important point in the topics is missed. So other topics like SLE pleural effusion, I have made notes and already posted the videos. If you happen to see this video first, please go to the other videos in the playlist and see all the Harrison videos. These are very important for MD internal medicine, DNB internal medicine candidates, and also for NEET SS and NEET PG preparing students, okay, or even DM students also, like who are doing DM in their particular specialties. Okay, so this is from the God of Medicine, that is Harrison's textbook. So let us continue to the topic now. Sarcoidosis. By definition, sarcoidosis is an inflammatory disease characterized by non-caseating granulomas. And it is a multi-system disease and it requires the presence of the disease features or involvement of two or more organs. Most common organ affected is lung. Other common organs are liver, skin and eye. It can affect any organ in the body. Half the patients have remission in few years of diagnosis. Other half will prolong into chronic disease, okay, that can last for decades. Coming to etiology. The exact cause is unknown. Most likely etiology can be infectious or non-infectious environmental agent that triggers an inflammatory response in a genetically susceptible host. Okay, genetically susceptible host is a key risk factor along with other combination of factors like Propionibacter acnes infection, this is a bacterium, okay, or presence of MCATG protein. Okay, so what is MCATG protein? It is Mycobacterium catalase peroxidase. And exposure to insecticides, molds is also one of the risk factors. Healthcare workers are at huge risk. Okay, so it is common in young, otherwise healthy adults. Mean age of diagnosis of sarcoidosis is 55 years. Mostly it is sporadic. 5% have familial incidence. It is most common in Afro-American people, Irish people. Okay, especially the familial pattern is more common in Afro-American and Irish people. Coming to pathophysiology, granuloma is a pathological hallmark of sarcoidosis. Local accumulation of inflammatory cells will be seen. Influx of helper T cells and accumulation of activated monocytes is seen. HLA-DR-B1, that is 1101 haplotype, is associated with increased risk of developing sarcoidosis. Macrophage helper T cell cluster provokes release of various cytokines, IL-2 from T cells, interferon gamma and TNF from macrophage. T cell is very important for the inflammatory response. So this is the irony, just listen here. In advanced HIV infection, patients will have less helper T cell or they will not have helper T cells. And so sarcoidosis is very rarely developed in these patients. In some HIV patients, sarcoidosis gets masked, unmasked after antiretroviral therapy because immune system is restored then. And again to the irony, cyclosporin, which is the drug of the choice that downregulates the helper T cells, okay, cyclosporin, it seems to have little impact on sarcoidosis. We don't know why. 20% of sarcoidosis develop chronic disease. They have increased levels of IL-8, IL-17, CXCL9 and TNF, okay. And a similar presentation will happen in a seen in a syndrome called Lofgren syndrome. Now we'll discuss what is Lofgren syndrome. Lofgren syndrome constitutes of three things mainly: erythema nodosum. Erythema nodosum is present in sarcoidosis also, but again in Lofgren syndrome, it is transient and painful rash, okay, red hot rash, usually seen in the extensor aspect of the lower limbs. Okay, as a part of the inflammatory response. And hilar adenopathy and chest X-ray will be seen, and periarticular arthritis is also seen. 90% of the patients with Lofgren syndrome will have good prognosis. Okay, unlike sarcoidosis. Okay, so coming to clinical manifestations, 1/3 can be asymptomatic. Common symptoms are cough, dyspnea on exertion and stridor. So again, like when patient presents with dyspnea on exertion, we think of cardiac causes. But when stridor is there, that is definitely related to respiratory. So when cough is there, when X-ray shows hilar lymphadenopathy and all those stuff, we should be suspecting sarcoidosis. Skin and ocular symptoms can be present like rash, dry eyes, uveitis symptoms. Non-specific constitutional symptoms like fatigue, okay, it's very common. Fatigue is very common in sarcoidosis. Fever, night sweats and weight loss, it resembles the tuberculosis only. But when you think it is TB, and some cases can be sputum negative, but still we strongly suspect TB because evening rise of temperature, night sweats, weight loss, fatigue can be there, fever and all. So even if the patient doesn't respond to anti-tubercular therapy, then the strong suspicion should be there with sarcoidosis, because the treatment is completely different. Here the treatment will be steroids. Okay, so systemic involvement in sarcoidosis. Let us see system by system now. Lung involvement, cough, very common symptom, occurs in more than 90% of the sarcoidosis patients. Chest x-ray, common mode of diagnosis. It shows bilateral hilar lymphadenopathy. CT scan shows peribronchial thickening and reticular nodular changes. Though CT scan is more sensitive, x-ray, okay, x-ray scoring has, it is a standard scoring system called SCADing scoring system, okay. So CT scan is more sensitive, but we do x-ray, and there's a scoring system called SCADing standard scoring system, okay. This is a preferred method for staging in chest involvement. So what is SCADing scoring system in chest x-ray? Stage 1, hilar adenopathy. Mostly right paratracheal nodes are involved. Stage 2, hilar adenopathy plus pulmonary infiltrates. Stage 3, pulmonary infiltrates alone. And stage 4, pulmonary fibrosis. So don't get confused here. Stage 2 is hilar adenopathy plus pulmonary infiltrates, whereas stage 3 is only pulmonary infiltrates. Okay. Next, we'll move to upper lobe fibrosis. So this is an extra point here. In which conditions upper lobe fibrosis is seen? So, in non-infectious causes like hypersensitivity, pneumonitis, silicosis, Langerhans-Cell, histiocytosis. Infectious causes like tuberculosis, aspergillosis, pneumocystis, pneumonia. There are many other causes. These are the common ones. So, here, diffuse lung capacity of carbon monoxide, that is DLCO, is the most sensitive test in interstitial lung disease of sarcoidosis. One-third of the sarcoidosis have normal lung volumes, whereas decreased DLCO is seen in restrictive or restrictive lung disease, or reduced volumes are seen. Okay, half of the sarcoidosis patients will have obstructive pattern. So as we know, FEV1 by FVC is reduced in obstructive pattern of the disease. So varying degrees of airway involvement is seen. Some patients will have airway hyperreactivity, and it is tested by positive methacholine test. So patient breathes nebulized methacholine histamine. 20% or more decrease in breathing ability, diagnosis of asthma is made. Okay, so asthma like condition is seen in few patients. So pulmonary arterial hypertension is seen in 5% of sarcoidosis patients, either due to vascular involvement or due to lung fibrosis. Okay, in sarcoidosis patients end stage fibrosis waiting for lung transplantation, most of them, that is 70%, will have pulmonary artery hypertension. 50% of symptomatic patients have pulmonary artery hypertension. Coming to skin involvement, it is seen in 1/3 of patients with sarcoidosis. Classic skin lesions include erythema nodosum, maculopapular lesions, hyper and hypopigmentation, and keloid formation. Okay. Then lupus pernio on the face, very important manifestation of skin. This is area of rash involving the bridge of the nose, okay, under eyes and cheeks. Okay, the nasolabial folds are spade ear, okay, unlike SLE. Lupus pernio is very helpful in diagnosis of chronic form of sarcoidosis. Okay, so if the patient presents to you in the OPD and if he has or she has lupus pernio, then it is mostly like the patient can progress to chronic form of sarcoidosis. And it is common in Afro-Americans. Coming to erythema nodosum, it is painful transient rash mostly associated with hilar lymphadenopathy, okay, and uveitis. It is common in women and white population. So maculopapular rash is also common, and it indicates chronic form of disease, and it shows non-caseating granulomas on skin biopsy. Coming to eye manifestations of sarcoidosis, the frequency of ocular manifestation depends on the race. In Japan, more than 70% of sarcoidosis patients develop ocular disease. In United States, 30% will have eye disease. It is more in Afro-Americans. Most common manifestation of eye is anterior uveitis. Over 1/4 of the patients have retinitis and pars planitis. Other symptoms include photophobia, blurred vision, and tearing. Okay, some develop blindness. Yearly ophthal examination is mandatory. Sicca is seen in half of the chronic sarcoidosis patients. What is sicca? Dry eyes plus dry mouth. Dry eyes is, it requires natural tears and lubricants. Okay. Liver involvement, biopsy can detect half of the cases with liver involvement. Sorry, because the picture is not clear, but I have already made this as a, you know, picture, PDF. So I'll read it out. If any thing is not clear, please just listen to it and rectify it. Okay. So coming to liver involvement, biopsy can detect half of the cases with liver involvement. Only 20 to 30% of the liver involvement is detected by liver function tests. So increased alkaline phosphatase is significant. Transaminases can be raised. Elevated bilirubin is seen in advanced liver disease. Okay. The symptoms are due to hepatomegaly, intrahepatic cholestasis leading to portal hypertension. And it can manifest as esophageal varices and ascites. 5% of liver symptoms of sarcoidosis require specific therapy. Rarely require liver transplant because even if cirrhosis is present, they respond to therapy. So this is one of the, sarcoidosis is one of the very few condition where it responds, cirrhosis responds to therapy. Because if the patient has cirrhosis, most of the time they'll progress and they'll need liver transplantation. But in this case, it will respond to therapy, which is steroids or immunosuppressants. So bone marrow and spleen involvement. Most common hematological manifestation is lymphopenia, very important. Okay. So reflection of sequestration of lymphocytes in areas of inflammation. Okay. So there will be more gathering of lymphocytes in the area of inflammation. So there will be less lymphocytes in the blood. So lymphocytosis, so that is more lymphocytes is present in bronchoalveolar lavage. Okay. So in bronchoalveolar lavage, that is BAL, lymphocytosis is seen, whereas in blood it is lymphopenia. Anemia is present in 20% of the patients. Leukopenia is less common. Bone marrow examination shows granulomas in 1/3 of the patients. Splenomegaly in 5 to 10% of the patients. Splenic biopsy shows granuloma in 60% of the patients. CT scan shows it is specific for diagnosing granuloma of spleen. Splenectomy is indicated for massive symptomatic splenomegaly and profound pancytopenia. Non-thoracic lymphadenopathy occurs in 20% of the patients. Okay. On calcium metabolism, there will be hypercalcemia, hypercalciuria, because granulomas produce 125 dihydroxy vitamin D. Okay. And there will be increased intestinal absorption of calcium and decreased parathormone level plus hypercalcemia, and there is formation of renal calculi. So serum calcium levels and 24-hour urine calcium levels to be monitored every now and then, that is 6 months once in sarcoidosis patients. Coming to renal disease, less than 5% of sarcoidosis patients have renal manifestations. Granulomas in kidney can cause nephritis. Most common cause of sarcoidosis associated with renal disease is hypercalcemia. And it can be treated with glucocorticoids. 1 to 2% can land up in acute renal failure. Nervous system, 5 to 10% of sarcoidosis patients have CNS manifestations. It can be central or peripheral nervous system involvement. MRI shows granulomatous inflammation. Gadolinium enhanced MRI can show space occupying lesions. CSF analysis shows lymphocytic meningitis with mild increase in protein. CSF glucose is low. Most common CNS involvement in sarcoidosis is cranial nerve involvement, basilar meningitis, myelopathy, anterior hypothalamic disease can be there, or it can land up into central diabetes insipidus. Seizures and cognitive changes can also occur rarely. Seventh nerve involvement can occur, and it is very important because if there is seventh nerve involvement alone and the patient presents with seventh nerve involvement alone, we may mistakenly diagnose as Bell's palsy. Okay, so don't diagnose Bell's palsy until you do the necessary test, especially chest x-ray and stuff, if the necessary symptoms are there. Okay. So optic neuritis can occur. Okay. And CNS manifestations may occur and dissolve before actual diagnosis of sarcoidosis is made sometimes. So in optic neuritis, it's a chronic form, so it requires long-term systemic therapy. It is associated with anterior and posterior uveitis also. DD for optic neuritis is multiple sclerosis. And multiple sclerosis is not associated with anterior uveitis. So that is a differentiating factor here. So meningeal enhancement and hypothalamic enhancement is seen in MRI. Okay. And it suggests neurosarcoidosis, especially if you tally with other symptoms of sarcoidosis like skin and pulmonary involvement. If they are present, so that is almost confirmed that it is neurosarcoidosis. Treatment is glucocorticoids and cytotoxic therapy. Facial diplegia can be present, that is bilateral facial nerve palsy. Okay, so bilateral facial nerve palsy, in very few conditions it is present. Here I have made extra note about it, like where it is present, I'll read it for you. So causes of bilateral facial nerve palsy can be sarcoidosis, Lyme's disease, Guillain-Barré syndrome, B benign intracranial hypertension, brainstem encephalitis, HIV, infectious mononucleosis, Melkerson-Rosenthal syndrome. Okay, what is Melkerson-Rosenthal syndrome? Facial palsy plus granulomatous keratitis plus fissured tongue. So these are the causes, okay, of bilateral facial nerve palsy. It is out of the topic, but important, so I mentioned here. And coming to cardiac manifestations of sarcoidosis, due to infiltration of heart by granulomas, congestive heart failure or cardiac arrhythmias can occur. And they can be performed with LV ejection fraction of left ventricle less than 10%, very severe. So ejection fraction can be improved by systemic therapy. Okay, the good thing about sarcoidosis is once the diagnosis is made and you start steroids or systemic therapy, whatever it is, immunosuppressants or steroids, the patient responds to it in whatever condition he may be until he goes to the final stage. So if AV node is infiltrated, heart blocks also can occur and can be detected by echo. Ventricular arrhythmias and VT can also occur and can cause sudden death. Okay, arrhythmias are best detected by 24-hour ambulatory monitoring. Cardiac sarcoidosis is diagnosed by MRI and PET scanning. Ablation therapy not useful for ventricular arrhythmias as granulomas are patchy and multifocal, can be considered for implanted defibrillator. Okay, so therapy can be implanted defibrillator install like placement. And systemic therapy helps to reduce arrhythmias, but arrhythmias can be present up to 6 months of starting the treatment, and they can recur when the medications are tapered. Okay, so sarcoidosis is a very vague disease. The treatment is also vague, or you only give steroids, and symptoms can appear in some patients based on how the body reacts to it and your immune status. Okay, so musculoskeletal system involvement, myalgia, arthralgia, fatigue can be there. What is the reason of fatigue? Is due to small peripheral nerve fiber disease. Okay, so this is important question. Why it happens in sarcoidosis and why it is very severe is due to small peripheral nerve fiber disease. Granuloma can be demonstrated in X-ray, MRI and PET scan. Other organ involvement, breast, testis, ovary or stomach, biopsy to rule out. Cancer can be done, mammogram, ultrasound, MRI can be done when required. Coming to complications of sarcoidosis, can lead to blindness due to optic neuritis or anterior posterioritis, paraplegia, renal failure. Death is seen in less than 5% of the patient. Most commonly, it is due to respiratory failure, as we discussed, arrhythmias or angioinvasive mycetoma. Okay, this is a fungal disease. It can cause invasion of the blood vessels, and it can lead to massive bleeding from Aspergillus niger lung infection. Okay, so now due to COVID-19 infection, the secondary disease called mucormycosis, that is black fungus, is has become very popular and famous, and it's too much troubling and so much morbidity due to mucormycosis. So this is a similar infection, that is Aspergillus niger, causing angioinvasive mycetoma in sarcoidosis. You should remember this. Okay, use of immunosuppressing agents can cause serious infections. So laboratory findings, chest x-ray, CT, and hilar lymphadenopathy more than 2 centimeters is seen. Paratracheal nodes are involved. Okay, pre and paratracheal. So PET scan shows granulomas, that is PET scan is very much useful compared to gallium 67 scan, and it identifies granulomas. Later biopsy can be done based on the confirmation, for confirmation. So cardiac PET is useful, MRI is helpful in extrapulmonary sarcoidosis. Coming to gadolinium enhancement, it is useful to detect granulomas in brain, heart and bone. Serum ACE levels are increased in 60% of acute and 20% of the chronic cases. So ACE is angiotensin converting enzyme. So again, extra knowledge for you guys, like extra point, wherein ACE levels are increased, in which conditions? Mostly in sarcoidosis. First condition is sarcoidosis. Okay, ACE levels, like they are increased in sarcoidosis, Gaucher's disease, leprosy, hyperthyroidism, miliary tuberculosis, and very mild in diabetes. So now we'll come to the diagnosis. Cannot be made with 100% accuracy. Can be made from physical features, laboratory plus pathological findings combined. Okay, so there are two possibilities. First thing, biopsy. First, the patient comes with a lesion, and we do biopsy and it shows granuloma. Okay, and in the granuloma, no alternate diagnosis made and clinical features supportive of sarcoidosis, then it is sarcoidosis. Suppose patient presents with a feature of sarcoidosis like cough, stridor, or lupus ponio or erythronodism. Then X-ray shows higher lymphadenopathy. Then you go for biopsy, then granulomas are seen, then it is sarcoidosis. If granulomas are not seen, then test for ACE levels. If it is more than 2 times of upper limit, And if a bronchoalveolar lavage shows lymphocytosis or gallium scan shows some signs favoring like panda sign, lambda sign. Okay, I'll tell you what are those signs now a little later. Okay, panda, lambda sign in gallium scan. Okay, or galaxy sign in CT scan. Then it is sarcoidosis. Okay. So, if no other diagnosis specifically is found and if any features are favoring it, it is sarcoidosis. Now, we'll come to little signs on sarcoidosis. Galaxy sign, HRCT finding of granuloma. In this, like large pulmonary nodule composed of multiple small nodules surrounded by satellite nodules. You can search galaxy sign in, internet. In galaxy sign of sarcoidosis, you can see lot of pictures. Okay, now I'm not showing it because the video will be very prolonged if I keep on showing and discussing about it. So here let's focus on the Harrison nodes. Okay, so just like you can pass for 1 minute and just check galaxy sign, this panda sign, and see the pictures in the internet. Okay, in Google many beautiful pictures are there. Panda sign in gallium 67 citrate scan. Panda sign is due to bilateral involvement of parotid glands and lacrimal glands. So there will be like two eyes. More uptake will be taken here. Okay, so that is panda scan. And coming to lambda sign. Why it shows the uptake will be in the form of a lambda. Okay. That is because of involvement of the hilar lymph nodes. Okay. And the right side, that upstroke of lambda is seen due to right paratracheal lymph node involvement. Okay. So next, complementary test. Pulmonary involvement biopsies can be done. Bronchial biopsy, transbronchial biopsy for parenchymal disease. Endobronchial US guided transbronchial needle aspirate can be done. Okay, so this is Harrison. Yes, it will be like this only, little complex. So please bear with me. I know, I'm also reading and my throat is also aching. Finally, it will end in another 5 minutes. Just bear with me, okay? And hope the concept is going in your mind. If it doesn't go, fine. Like, you have to, listen for 1 to 2 times and you'll understand it better. But just believe me, if you, this half an hour video, this topic is done. Okay, almost completely done. Except the pictures and tables, I'm missing little. Even the tables, most of the time, I have converted into notes. But if you have to sit and read, it takes a lot of time. Okay. So definitely I hope and wish these videos are beneficial to you guys. And I please need your sincere feedback in the comment so that it will be encouraging for me to do further videos. I should know whether you are getting benefited from this or not. Okay. So I told about bronchial biopsy. So always rule out malignancy if granulomas are present. Okay. So ACE levels are increased in sarcoidosis, I already told you. But in case of malignancy, they are normal. Okay, so that's the point there. And bronchoalveolar lavage, I already told, lymphocytosis is there. And CD4 by CD8 ratio is greater than 3.5. Positive PET scan, multiple organs are affected in positive PET scan. There was a procedure done before for sarcoidosis confirmation that is called Quine-Silsbach procedure. Sometimes it may be rarely asked in the questions because it is not asked because it's not done recently. Okay, in this, the tissue of spleen from positive sarcoidosis patient is taken and injected to the suspect. If non-caseating granulomas are present, then the test is positive. It is not used nowadays because it transmits prion disease, that is Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. Okay, so coming to the final part, treatment. Okay, the treatment is simple. Okay, steroids and immunosuppressants. Just a note on it. Okay. Treatment based on the symptoms, presence of organ and life-threatening disease, and based on the eye, heart and nervous system, we will decide the treatment. Patients of mild symptoms should be monitored for evidence of progressive and systemic disease. The drug of choice is glucocorticoids. So in acute disease, if there are minimal symptoms and there are no symptoms, but there are abnormalities of neurocardiac or ocular, or if there is hypercalcemia, then start systemic therapy. If there are no abnormalities, only mild symptoms, just observe. And if single organ is affected, like eye or skin or only cough, then topical steroids is enough. So you can either use a topical ointment or you can use drops or nasal spray or something like that. If more than one organ is affected, you have to go for systemic therapy. So symptomatic patient with multiple organ involvement, you have no choice but to go for systemic therapy, that is glucocorticoids, prednisolone. So finally, initial dose, I'll tell you the initial dose later, but you have to taper in such a way that it will come to 10 milligrams or less than 10 milligrams within 6 months of the starting of therapy. So you can continue prednisolone that time. But you are not able to taper to less than 10 milligrams. Suppose if you try to taper to less than 10 milligrams, but the patient's symptoms are aggravated, then you have to add other drugs like methotrexate, hydroxychloroquine and azathioprine. Okay. So management of chronic disease, glucocorticoids are well tolerated in chronic disease also. Dose, as I told, it should be less than 10 milligrams per day for the chronic disease if it is effective. If it is not effective, alternative agents like all this what I mentioned, plus leflunomide, mycophenolate, minocycline. Even if those are not effective, then go to infliximab, cyclophosphamide, thalidomide and adalimumab. Okay. So now I'll tell about prednisolone dose. Okay. So the usual dose, initial dose is 20 to 40 milligrams once a day. Then taper to 5 to 10 milligrams once a day. That is maintenance dose. So a few points about treatment. High dose for steroids is recommended in and useful in neurosarcoidosis. Whereas low dose is recommended and useful in cutaneous sarcoidosis. Hydroxychloroquine dose is 200 to 400 milligrams per day. Okay. And minocycline is effective in cutaneous sarcoidosis. Prognosis, risk of death is low, only 5% as we mentioned before. Poor prognosis, advanced disease with irreversible fibrotic changes. Okay. If advanced disease with irreversible fibrotic changes are there, then poor prognosis. If disease results in 2 to 5 years, then it is good prognosis. Okay, if it is more than 2 to 5 years and still they have symptoms and all, like it is bad prognosis. So, these bad prognosis patients can be identified initially only when they present to the OPD. How? When you see the patient and when there is fibrosis on chest x-ray and the patient has lupus pernia and there are cysts in the bone cysts, cardiac or neuro manifestations are there and renal calculi due to hypercalciuria is there. If patient requiring glucocorticoids within 6 months of presentation, they mostly land up in chronic disease and they will have poor prognosis. So finally, we are done with the sarcoidosis. Please listen multiple times and give the feedback to me and which topics in Harrison you want and which are very important, because you guys will be having more. Those who want to read Harrison, you would have listed, you might have already listed the important topics. Okay. So please mention what topic you want and I'll definitely study, make a notes and make the video of it. Thank you and very, very, very good luck, guys.